My people, this video is aimed at players who are in the mid to late game on their farm. I would classify that as anyone who has made it to Ginger Island, all the way up to anyone who has not quite reached perfection, and everyone in between. If that's you, I hope that the next 20 tips will help you change the way you play Stardew Valley for the better. Tip number one, between sprinklers, scarecrows, and Junimo huts, it can be hard to know exactly how to organize your crops. I'll cut right to the chase, this is my favorite layout for organizing my farming. There's probably a slightly better way to do this by utilizing pressure nozzles, but this setup allows you to grow 192 crops that will be harvested by Junimos and are protected from crows. Plus, I end up designing most of my farms in sort of a grid-style layout anyway, so this fits perfectly. So once you've laid out the sprinklers on your farm, you'll want to start processing your crops. I overlooked kegs and preserves jars for a long time, but utilizing them will multiply the money that you make by a ridiculous amount. I used to worry about finding space on my farm to dedicate to processing crops, but then I realized that kegs could be put anywhere, meaning that you literally can't have too many of them. Put them in barns, put them in the forest, put them in the desert, put them everywhere. Endgame farms grow thousands of crops every season, and every keg that you have waiting is just more money in the bank. If you don't feel like littering the map with kegs, sheds are probably your next best bet, but it can be tough to know when you should pop in to collect your goods. May I introduce the indicator? Basically, if you've got a shed of preserves jars, for example, just put one of them outside to let you know when all of the ones inside are ready as well. This will save you time and prevent you from looking like a fool. There is a limit, however, to the number of casks that you can have, since they can only be placed in basements. You could put 125 casks in a basement while still leaving room to walk, but what if I told you that we could fit more? If you fill in all of the walkways, you can fit a total of 189 casks in the basement, a 51% increase. Here is the reason why I don't think this is overkill. When you put wine in a cask, it takes 14 days to go from basic to silver quality, then another 14 days to go from silver to gold, then another 28 days to go from gold to iridium. But you don't have to take the wine out of the cask for each step. So in reality, you just put the wine in, then wait 2 seasons, then take it out. So you only need to break your way through casks to harvest wine twice a year, which I think is worth the extra 64 casks that you can place. While we're on the topic of making a ton of money through farming, we need to talk about the island farm. The optimal layout involves ancient fruit and makes you over 300,000 gold every day, but it can take quite a long time to set up. To learn how to best optimize the space, you'll have to watch my full video on it, but remember that the sooner you get it started, the better. After you watch that video, you should have an even better understanding of why you can't have too many casks. I wish I would have recognized the potential of the island farm earlier, and the same goes for the slime hutch. Because of the 1.5 update, the slime hutch has become one of the best passive money makers in the game. Again, I did a whole breakdown on this video about how to set up your slime hutch, so watch that for all the details. If you've watched a lot of my other videos, you may have noticed that professions factor into a lot of methods. You probably know that the Statue of Uncertainty allows you to swap professions, but how many of you have been playing on the same farm for years with the same profession that you chose in the early game? I encourage you to just take some time to think through your current professions and ask yourself if you should switch any around. If you don't know what professions are best, don't worry, I've got a guide on that too. 3 self-promotions in less than 60 seconds? Getting kinda good at this YouTube thing. There were a lot of money-making and efficiency tips there in a row, so let's talk about some quality of life improvements you can make. Junimo chests are one of my favorite rewards from Key's Walnut Room. I think they're perfect for storing tools and other very commonly used items, but placement is key. Before you have the Return Scepter and the Island Obelisk, keeping one Junimo chest on your main farm and the other one on your island farm is a great option. Later on, you could keep one on your main farm and one just outside of the mines. Whatever you decide, it's nice to have better access to your most commonly used items. Sticking with the theme of storage, someone from my Twitch chat told me about this next tip and I have never been the same since I heard it. To help with your journey getting max hearts with all of the villagers, you should keep a chest just outside of their bedrooms with a bunch of their loved gifts. You'll have immediate access to the best item to give each person, but more importantly, you won't have to remember what each villager's favorite things are. This, combined with keeping an object most people like on me at all times, has helped me get my hearts up tremendously. Getting to max hearts with the villagers is one of the harder requirements for perfection, but you should also start the process of shipping every item, cooking every dish, crafting everything, and catching every fish as early as you can. These requirements all have aspects that can only be completed during certain times of the year, so start these early if you don't want to find yourself one requirement shy of perfection and having to wait 3 seasons to finish it. On a similar note, you should always keep a few of everything in a chest somewhere. Even after years of playing this game, I still find myself unexpectedly needing different items that I don't have access to because of the season. Although it may normally be easy to get objects like Fairy Rose in the fall, you don't want to have to wait for months until Pierre sells it. Pierre and the other townspeople may let you down, but the Wizard's Tower is open from 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. every day, or all the way until 2 a.m. if you have the key to the town. I'm telling you this because whenever I needed to move a farm building, I used to have to head to Robin's during a particular window when she was working, and many times I would miss her and have to wait until the next day. But I realized that you can use the Wizard's Podium at any time to move farm buildings, which is just way more convenient. I've got two quick tips that are helpful for improving the way your farm looks, but take them with a grain of salt because my eye for design is a bit off. One thing that I do know, however, is that hiding lighting behind existing structures is a fantastic way to add life to your home or farm. My favorite option is torches because they're small and fit behind almost everything, but you can also walk right over top of them so they don't get in your way. For some of the cosmetic items, you have a limited time when you have the chance to pick them up. The ones you really need to watch out for are the paintings from the famous Lupini, since each painting can only be bought on one night every 3 years. The other set of collectibles that's like this is in the movie theater, because some of the rewards from the claw machine are only available when a certain movie is playing, which is on a 2-year cycle. Okay, back to efficiency. This was hard for me to accept, but I finally have come to terms with the fact that hammers are the best weapon type. Everyone has their preference, but the AoE of the hammer's special attack just can't be beat. It deals so much damage and makes it so easy to protect yourself that you should never have an issue fighting again. But if you disagree, let me know in the comments why I'm wrong. But personally, I believe that once you've got enough galaxy souls, you should use them to make the Infinity Gavel. The Burglar's Ring is a must-have for item collection. On average, it doubles the loot that you get from monster drops, so you'll get twice as much out of every kill. This is huge for farming items like coal from dust sprites, so get yourself a Burglar's Ring as soon as possible. For a more complete guide on item collection, Mr. Penguin Panda's video is really good. Monster drops aren't the only way to pick up large quantities of materials. I always found myself needing more wood when I was in the mid-game, until I found my solution. You can turn the desert into a massive tree farm. Even if you just fill in all of the space above the road with trees, you'll get around 2,000 wood every time you cut them all down. This area can't be used for much else, so it's the perfect spot to farm. If you're looking for fiber, the Mutant Bug Cave is where you want to be. There are so many weeds in here that one trip through should get you set up for a long time. You may not think of fiber as something that you need a lot of, but once you get the golden clock and weeds stop spawning on your farm, you're going to need some way of saving it up for crafting. The best way to get stone is a little less obvious. I used to put diamonds in my crystallariums, since they were the most gold per day, but I realized a far more valuable gem is the jade. Jades can be traded in to the desert trader on Sundays to get staircases, which are massively helpful for the skull cavern. Even with just 10 or so crystallariums, you can find yourself with hundreds of staircases very quickly. Like I said, you can use these staircases for the skull cavern, or you can put them into a deconstructor and get 99 stone back each. Jades are produced fast enough that you should never run out of stone using this technique. And for my final tip for endgame farms, you should always have the speed boost from a triple shot espresso. The extra speed helps you in everything that you do, and wearing a hot Java ring for day-to-day stuff will get you enough coffee to last forever. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope this was helpful. If you guys have any more tips, let everyone know. I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.